Hello, and welcome to Conversations with the Voice of Reason. I'm your host, Benjamin Boyce, and today's conversants are Stella O'Malley and Eliza Mondegreen, who are both returning guests, and Stella is the founder of Genspect and the co-host, along with Sasha Ayad, of Gender, A Wider Lens podcast, and Eliza Green is a very prolific investigative researcher and writer into the transition and gender topic. In this conversation, we talk about gender discourse broadly and about the gender medical industrial complex and the problems with that. And we also talk about the upcoming conference hosted by Genspect in Killarney, Ireland, which is occurring at the end of the month of April, in just about a month, and I'll be there too. So if you happen to be in Killarney, Ireland, swing by and let's grab a pint together. Otherwise, just lean on back, get yourself a Guinness or a cup of tea or mug, if that is your situation, and enjoy the show. Here is Stella O'Malley and Eliza Mondegreen.
Well, hasn't this weekend been very extraordinary? Or has it for you guys over in America?
Are you talking about New Zealand?
Yeah, and then in London today.
Well, okay, so there was the lesbian event yesterday. What happened today? I couldn't tell if that was about yesterday or if that was something...
Oh, it's something new. It just feels like it's kicking off. Like, so today is just Speaker's Corner, which is kind of where... started everything, but I don't know even know if Posey's there. I don't think she is, actually. It's just the kind of traditional place where people would gather, and the trans activists surrounded the gender critical people, and it looked horrible. You know, they were singing things like "the only good Nazi is a dead Nazi," and
You know, my friend James Lindsay, he made a really terrible suggestion about the left wanting a drag Floyd. That's what they're working toward, because if they can get a drag Floyd, then they can kick off a huge revolution with regard to gender and just shove it down every institution's throat. Look at these, they just need a sacrificial lamb. But if the trans rights activists beat the leftists, to the punch and kill a turf, then do we have a turf Floyd? It's not going to work in that. It only works in one direction. But they're going to get as close to violence as possible. They're going to get absolutely as close to violence as possible just to get the men out there beating the crap out of them, just to get the response. The action is the reaction. And the women aren't able to do that because, I mean, they're not filled with testosterone, but eventually a man's going to snap.
Oh, God.
Yeah. I mean, it's just such a dangerous...
grand strategy.
It's just so irresponsible to tell people that it's a trans genocide and like there's going to be a day of vengeance in Washington, D.C. on April Fool's Day. They said it's not an April Fool's Day thing. And it's
joke.
Just like, oh my God, it's not a joke.
What, how do you do a day of vengeance? Like how are they actually going to do that? Are they going to throw like the testicles of oxen at passerbys? Like,
I don't know. I mean, I feel like the urine protest was already done.
Yeah. Oh yeah. But day of vengeance, the language is getting...
The language is alarming.
Yeah.
Day of... I shouldn't laugh, but...
Yeah. Anyway.
What are your reads on that? How does that intersect with both of yours work? Because you're both... I'm sure you both get some form of harassment and threats.
Yeah. Well, do you want to go first or will I, Eliza?
Go ahead.
It does intersect. You know, I have been very unfairly attacked in many different, really scurrilous ways. That does make you furious, because there's almost nothing more frustrating than being attacked for something you haven't done, or being blamed or accused for something you haven't done, and then finding it difficult to get it out what actually happened and being rained on. It's really frustrating position to be put into, and I have been many, many times since I started having anything to do with gender. And so you can see, I come from Ireland and I did see the history of people being radicalized in the north. I saw an awful lot of radicalization happening in my own lifetime, And so I can understand the process of radicalization, and I think it has happened. And I think people get maddened. And I used to say it about the North in Ireland, like I used to say, I can see why, you know, 10 men starved themselves to death. Like, it's so insane that that's what they did in the 1980s in Ireland and more, you know, many, many more tragedies and awful, terrible, terrible things happened. And I would say they were maddened. They'd gone mad. They had actually gone mad. And people do get radicalized. People do get maddened. And that's very frightening because the result of that is awful.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I haven't had nearly the public profile that Stella has had. So I haven't had nearly the threats and misrepresentations, although there is something that's just, like, I think uniquely awful about when you're trying to speak really clearly and you're picking your words really carefully. And it's like people can't hear a word that you say. And I've had that experience so far much more with people that I know, you know, in real life, like with friends or colleagues, than with, like, you know, the general public twisting my words. But that's like a really unreal experience. And I think on the point of, like, Stella, what you're saying about radicalization, the concept that I keep coming back to is that phobia indoctrination concept that, like, Steve Hassan, the cult expert, talks about, where it's like, if you're part of this controlling group, this manipulative group, that one of the ways to keep the membership in line is to instill them these irrational fears and phobias about a bunch of things. Like, one of them is the outside world and the threats that they face there. And another kind of set of irrational fears is, like, okay, the fear of letting your thoughts wander and the fear of thinking freely about the subject that's kind of at the heart of your indoctrination. And I think that we are, like, the evidence that this kind of phobia indoctrination is taking place has been really clear for years, but in the last couple of months, with all of the trans genocide and Days of Vengeance, and just, like, it seems like the fever pitch just keeps going up and up and up. And it is scary.
At what point does histrionics become history? Yeah, I guess that's the question.
Yeah, and it's like, there's a point where, you know, it doesn't matter if something's true or there's a point where if enough people believe something, it will be like it is true in some sense.
Oh, yeah.
Or they will act like it is true in some sense. And that seems to be where we're hitting with this, like, people reacting against this phantasm, and that's having real world effects. Mm-hmm.
I don't understand. So a couple of weeks ago, this is kind of old news, but I have to bring it up in this conversation, in my conversation with Christina Buttons, because it affected Christina Buttons, who worked for the Daily Wire in the capacity of a gender reporter, and then quit because she didn't like the rhetoric that was coming out of the Daily Wire, specifically Matt Walsh and Michael Knowles. But Michael Knowles at this conservative conference called CPAC said something. It was calculated. He didn't mince words. He said something. He led up to it, but the takeaway that went viral was, we need to eradicate transgenderism from the public discourse, which is, one, it's impossible to do. Like, there's no way to eradicate an idea. You can't do that from the public discourse, you know. He was trying to say that if it's not true that a man can be a woman, then it's not true that a boy can be a girl. We need to stop this, right? But he specifically used the word eradicate transgenderism.
Because had he been making a decent point, he could have said something along the lines of, we need to raise public awareness that living as a transgender person can cause an awful lot of, I know this isn't as catchy, but can cause an awful lot of distress, both for the person and for other people in society. Do you know what I mean? Like, that's somebody who's trying to inflame. And I can see why somebody would get very angry with that, because it's just like, you don't, like, there's one side that are very inflamed already, but I don't know. I find it hard. I can't say both sides, because there's no way that you could say that the women are at fault. You know what I mean? You really couldn't. They are reacting to being treated very badly. You know, if you go back to actually step by step sequence of events, that has happened. So when I say, you know, that they people could easily become radicalized and easily become maddened, that doesn't mean that they are equally at fault. It means that when you keep on treating at the same cohort very badly, messing mm-hmm. with their brain, accusing them wrongly, you're going to, I know this isn't the point you said, Benjamin, but I do want to kind of make that point. It doesn't mean that there's there's trouble on both sides or anything mm-hmm. like that. It doesn't mean that. It means we have to be careful not to go mad in the face of really awful treatment. Yeah.
Well, and you do bring up a good point, because the lay of the land isn't right versus left. And the left is trying to make it a left versus right thing. And the right is trying to make it a left versus right thing. But you have actual trans people, which is still a contentious term. I'm still wrestling with what I think about this. But you have, you know, the medicalization of children, the medical, the elective medicalization for people to solve a problem like gender distress. You have the elective medicalization for people to idealize their anima, let's say, to use like kind of like to uplift the AGP argument a little bit. Then you have the TERFs, you know, you have the radical feminists, right? In the TERF camp. Then you have people like Posey Parker who aren't really feminists. They actually like men mm-hmm. and want to be around men and have no truck with all that academic theory. But they're like, you know, get your balls out of my restroom, right? Yeah. And then you have the conservative group. And then you have like people like James Lindsay and myself who are like looking at all the theory. And then you have you two who are coming at it from different places. But these camps, like the TERFs are going to get are between a rock and a hard place. And then maybe the true trans or the non-ideological transitioners are right mm-hmm. there, like just being used by these cudgels, by people seeking power in this whole messy mess.
Yeah. I think if you choose to medically transition, with that comes a huge amount of impact on society. That needs to be.
You're willing to go on record saying that.
Shit.
Because the follow-up question is, what are those impacts from your point of view, or what is the responsibility for a medically transitioned individual?
I don't know, but I think this argument, because that's what it is at this stage, rather than a debate or a discussion, has really raised up issues around that. So I think we're still in the middle of grappling with that. I'm just saying there is an impact and it has to be acknowledged. Just every one of our choices, there is an impact. We have to look at what the impact I make on society, you make on society. To pretend we don't is false. Hmm. And so I do think that has to be, you know, we can't just say, oh, I don't know, that whole true trans thing just, my brain fries. I don't even know where to start. I never did have any belief in gender identity theory. Mm-hmm. I did have gender issues as a kid. So I always saw it as somebody who got stuck in a mindset, and it's a terribly distressing place to get stuck in. People can get stuck in many different mindsets in life, and they got stuck in a mindset and made the decision to medically transition, and that's a decision they make. And with it comes an awful lot of further distress and problems. And to discount all of that is so false. It has to be kind of, and it seems when you look at people and you get to know, and I'm sure all three of us know so many trans people now, and you look at Corinna Cohn and you look at Debbie Hayden and you look at Miranda and stuff, and you realize they're so more reflective as the years go on about mm-hmm. how it impacted. Just like when you get married or when you make any decision, you're like it, you know, at the start it's A and by the end of it it's J. Like it's a very it's a very different kind of scenario. So yeah. You freaked me out now, Benjamin.
Well, Eliza's, I guess it might be fair to say, but Eliza, you can dispute this, that one major through line of your work is to trace the impacts of, mm-hmm. you're tracing the impacts. You're looking at the different impacts that Stella's bringing up. So maybe you can like bring those to the fore?
Yeah. I think Helen Joyce put this in a really interesting way in terms of thinking about impacts. And it was like, if what would happen to the appeal of transition if it was like, you know, widely agreed that, okay, you're having these cosmetic procedures, these cosmetic surgeries, you're taking these pharmaceuticals, you're imitating the appearance of the opposite sex. And it doesn't mean that anybody is going to kind of participate in that fiction with you. And so you won't be using like the spaces of the opposite sex. You won't be referred to as the opposite sex. If that were like the public understanding of how to manage individuals who transition, what would that do to the allure of transition? Is, I think, a really interesting question, because a lot of that allure is like to get other people to play along to, so that you can stay inside this fiction that you really want to be true. And the only the extent to which it can be true is the extent to which other people play along.
And can I say that we do this all the time with our family and friends in many different contexts?
Mm-hmm.
The person who's anxious, who says, I just don't want to go out. Let's just stay in. And we all nod along saying, OK, we'll mm-hmm. stay. There's no reason why not to go out. But, you know, the anxious person has convinced us, and we're like, oh, let's just let it go. You know what I mean? We can still have a nice night, and we can still do it. And, you know, let's have a drink. And it's somebody who's, you know, people do it all the time in so many different contexts. We are, at the risk of being shot, we are kind to other people in different contexts. And they ask us, like, I've no doubt if, and I hope I will be meeting you both in Killarney, that, you know, you will, you know, gesture at some level to me, and I will gesture at some level to you in those few days. And we will kind of let things go, look the other way. We do it all the time
mm-hmm.
in so many ways. And some people ask so much more of us
mm-hmm.
and some people don't. And it can become really like the boiling frogs analogy. You are asking too much. It's got too hot, it's too deceitful, and I'm calling a line. And mm-hmm. I know, like in my work an awful lot with psychotherapy, I work an awful lot with people who love people with mental health issues, and that is the constant issue, is when do I draw a line and say, no, yeah. I'm not playing along with this. No, I don't think that's fair to ask me to play along.
Yeah. And I think it's really a question of like, right now, a lot of the drift of trans activism is to make it kind of socially, and even in some contexts, like legally impermissible not to play along. And we're kind of arguing for like, let's bring that individual line back where it's like, okay, I don't have to play along when it comes to where this impacts my rights or where this impacts kids. It's like, how can we draw lines again?
Wow.
There's
this, it gets really scary when you start to look at why the government's playing along with this, why big corporations are playing along with this, and not just like from the, like there's big money involved, but the amount of control mm-hmm. that you can influence, you can exert on a population if you can get them to, you know, lock themselves up in a house for a year, which is now turning out to be nobody wanted it and it didn't really do anything, or, you know, except that a man and a woman is a completely fluid concept that has no bearing on reality, and you need to accept this. I mean, it's really Orwellian, but if you look at where it, how it got into America, it's actually through the civil rights legislation, and mm-hmm. and there's this argument, there's this really powerful book called The Age of Entitlement by Christopher Caldwell. He shows that with the dawn of civil rights legislation, our old constitution, which was based on kind of negative rights and restraint of government, was overturned, and it was replaced by a new constitution that's based on litigation and enforcing fairness and giving the government unrestrained powers to resculpt society in its image. And this image of justice and fairness. And that started with race relations, and then it moved on to women's rights, and now it's back to men's rights, which would be the trans rights. And it's unstoppable. It's this huge machine. It's all geared up. Or gay rights was in there too. And it falls apart. It's kind of like our economic system. It falls apart if it's not continually like growing, if it's not continually like chipping away. Yeah.
Oh my God. Yeah. Fairness is become a very tricky concept, really. Mm-hmm. You know, being this whole equity and equality and what's the word, equality of opportunity and equality of outcome and all this sort of stuff. It's become really tricky. Like, it's mm-hmm. great that we're so sophisticated as societies that we're really trying to bring things on, you know, into really quite cerebral levels. But then you look, you go outside and you see people with very basic homelessness and very mm-hmm. basic, and you're thinking, wow, God, a lot of us are in ivory towers here. There's a huge amount of just academic, you know, cerebral kind of playing along with each other, playing, you know, mind playing, mm-hmm. rather than actually let's help society.
That's Eliza?
Sorry. Oh, yeah. I was just going to say, I mean, I lived in California for a while and worked there for many years, and it was just the surreal experience of, like, on paper, you couldn't have more equality or whatever it looks like on paper. And, you know, you walk down the street and there are people who have been homeless and living on the street for, you know, their entire adult lives, and people dying of overdoses on the street. And the disconnect was just incredibly, like, it was a painful level of dissonance between kind of like the vision and the reality.
Oof. And Eliza, being in academia, we're kind of bringing up a very academic mm-hmm. kind of way of playing with words, way of playing with reality. How are you doing going through the graduate program? And to what extent do you interact with that? And to what extent do you have to untangle that from your own mind and from your work?
So I'm in kind of an unusual program, and I'm now in the part where I'm just like staying at home and writing my thesis and kidnapping books from the library and keeping them for a year and a half. So my interaction with campus life is pretty limited right now, and that's probably a good thing. And I feel like the reason that I've had a pretty, like, I anticipated coming to grad school and like having no friends because of what I was researching. And that really wasn't the case. But the reason that I was able to have like some sanity was that I just completely stayed away from like student life stuff. And we were talking like right at the beginning about what happened in New Zealand and what happened at Speaker's Corner and what happened at the event for like lesbian women yesterday. And like there was a taste of that on my campus 2 months ago, because like some law society invited Robert Wintemute, the LGB Alliance member, somebody who'd worked on the Yogyakarta principles, and he was going to come and just talk about like the fact that there can be conflicts within human rights law. And he was going to talk about sex-based rights versus rights based on gender identity. And that talk was, like, it didn't happen. There were, I think well over 100 people who showed up to shut it down. And it was not, you know, it wasn't like what just happened to Posey Parker. It was like, I don't know if we're going to get out of here alive. But it was a scary situation because there were these, you know, well over 100 totally worked up cultural revolution energy activists. And there were four of us trying to attend the talk. And there was no security. There was no police. And they were not prevented from touching us. And so as soon as they had like grabbed us and started to manhandle us, it was like, okay, anything could happen here because they've broken that barrier.
Yeah.
And that, yeah, like, that was really scary.
And what happened?
I mean, we got pushed and pulled around and screamed at. And there was one of the women had, one of the women was pushed to the ground. One of the women had like a megaphone put in her ear, and someone was like screaming in her ear with a megaphone. And eventually they remembered that they had to let us leave since they weren't going to let us attend the talk. And so we were allowed to go outside, and there were a couple of people inside the talk along with the speaker where it was supposed to be happening. And the activists broke down the door and went in and unplugged the projector, and they threw flour on him. And anytime you get close enough to do that, it's always like, we could throw anything we wanted at you. You know, like that's the message.
Yeah.
And it was just completely,
what the
fuck? It was completely insane.
How was it? What was his threat to them?
was the threat to the activists?
Yeah, what was his, what
that
was
there
the
was going to
speaker's?
be a conversation about, like, there can be a conflict between sex-based rights and, like, what trans activists want.
And there can't be that conflict.
Right. The acknowledgement of a conflict is transphobic hate speech. And the fact that the four of us, about whom these activists knew absolutely nothing, like the fact that we wanted to attend the talk made us people who were outside of their social contract, which is a scary feeling.
I never heard of that.
Really? Oh my God. It was
Why didn't you film it, Eliza? You need to wear a GoPro at all times when you're on a campus.
Yeah. No, I was with someone who filmed it a little bit, but you know, it didn't become a huge story. And then it was so weird because my university pretended that it had never happened. Like, they deleted the event from the website. The speaker said that he never, like, no one ever reached out to him and was like, hey, we're really sorry that your event didn't happen. And I got an email that was like, we're sorry that you were unable to attend this event.
Whoa.
It was completely bizarre. So I would say I had a really positive experience up until the beginning of January when that happened.
Christ. That has all the ingredients. The whole nothing to see here, gaslighting, dishonesty,
yeah,
violence that's kind of always kind of there simmering, that we've been waiting and waiting and waiting for it to tumble. And it's going to tumble into proper violence. Yeah. We all know it will. It's just, when will it? You know, the closest... Yeah. Felt like, you know, Posey in New Zealand, but it's going to. We know it will.
Yeah, and you can just, I don't know, you read about these kind of things in history and it's very hard to imagine what it was like having never lived in such a time. And I, you know, it's interesting to go and be like, okay, this is what happens when everyone is convinced and they're fired up on this moral righteousness and they're acting like, you know, lives depend on us not getting to this lecture hall to hear this guy talk.
How many people were there against you as such? There was four of you.
I know there was over 100. It was really hard to tell because they were just all over us. And it just...
Oh my God.
It was really crazy.
And this is Montreal.
This is in Montreal.
Huh. Being inside a mob, I have accidentally kind of twice been in a mob. Both times I inadvertently ended up, like, one was kind of a riot, frankly, in Dublin, and another was in London. But both times, you feel the feverish animal. It's really, really tangible. You can feel the air of anybody could get killed here. It's really...
Right. It's like if there's one person who's a little more unhinged than anybody else, anything could happen.
Yeah, it's very...
And like, as soon as a line is crossed, anything can happen. So it was like, as soon as they touched us, it was like, okay, they could punch us because they already touched us, you know?
Jesus.
How did you get that out of your system, Eliza?
I'm not sure that I have. Like, I think it's going to be hard to forget what that felt like. Because seeing the video from New Zealand, it was like... Yeah.
Well, the weekend after, I've already told this story, but after the madness at Evergreen, I went to campus like right after the week of protest, and it was insanely oppressive. Like, nobody was on campus. It was a Sunday. I was just going in to do some work, and it was just the air was so dark and thick. I could barely breathe. And I realized, I'm like, oh, I can't even breathe. And then I went out after my shift. I went out, and there was this one guy, and there's these cement stairwells because everything's this brutalist architecture in the middle of this green forest. It's crazy. It looks like a prison. There's rumors that it was supposed to be a prison, but I think those are false. Anyway, so he was at the bottom of the stairwell. He was just playing a fiddle. And that vibration was actually, I could feel it. Like, he was pulling air into the space. He was pulling apart this thing, this dread. But they had summoned that, the teachers, the professors, and that's why I did the whole series, because I wanted to show that on a spiritual level, they summon this intention, they summon this spirit into this place. And with the internet and with trans ideology, I mean, I guess it's similar to communism. Communism had that massive effect all over all these different places, like this massive brain shattering, culture destroying effect.
Yeah. Wow. It's like you get a little taste of Red Guard energy and it's like, oh boy. Oh, there was something that I wanted to mention about the kind of the mob that shut down the talk. And it was after the four of us had been pushed outside, there was someone who came out to talk to us who had been kind of standing over like a very, very tall man. Yeah. And he had been kind of standing over us in a really intimidating way. And when we went out, he wanted to talk to us. And of course, you know, you're interested to hear what somebody says. And he said that he knew, how did he say it? He was like, he knew what we were like, or he knew what was going on with us because he used to be a neo-Nazi. Oh. And so he knew what it was to be, you know, motivated by hatred. And then he had, you know, he realized that he was really a woman, he was really a lesbian, and he had changed. And so he had this narrative of, you know, personal transformation. And it was like, you're doing the same thing. Like, what role do you see yourself playing in the situation? There had been this fantasy of transformation, and it was like, you didn't stop being a neo-Nazi. And he's standing, you know, he's out there and he's talking to us and he's kind of taunting us. And he's like, this is what it's going to be like for people like you in this country from now on.
Wow.
Because we wanted to attend a talk.
Right.
That was the only thing that he knew about us.
Yeah, it's like the alcoholic that becomes a born again Christian. It's the same person. They just have a mug of Jesus instead of a mug of beer or whatever. You know? Yeah. But it's the same attitude to the...
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, but it was just like, here's how you dress up harassment and intimidation and feel righteous about it.
You know, somebody like him, there he goes. And, you know, there are many of that person out there. But I suppose I have a much more evil eye towards the ordinary people who let it happen, if you follow me. I'm much more judgmental of them than like, oh, the crazy's being crazy. It's well, right. You know what I mean? Like, they've always been there. It's how society handles this is actually what matters. The college were the ones who were really the ordinary people who have good salaries, who needed to know who they were booking, why there was resistance. They have a position of responsibility and they're well paid for that. Mm-hmm. They're the ones, rather than neo-Nazi turned trans lesbian giving you a...
Right, it's like that person is like, turn into a responsible member of society, but it's the job of everybody else to like contain the damage that that person can do.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And then the aftermath, like I said, there was just nothing. There was nothing.
And that's a dereliction of duty. Oh, sorry, you couldn't attend. That's
right. Like, it didn't even say the talk didn't happen. It was like, you weren't able to attend.
And did you write them a...
I did write back. And I was like, this is a really surreal email to read because, you know, I was one of these people who was like pushed around outside this talk and there was no security. And like, what happened? And... Yeah. And they wrote back this really strange kind of non-apology for, not really for what happened, but for the email that was like, nothing happened.
Yeah, we're sorry.
We're sorry you felt that way.
Yeah, I know. I can imagine.
Yeah.
Stella, from a psychological point of view, how do you assist in creating the psychological conditions for somebody to go from a radicalization to a non-radicalization, or from a fundamentalist or very tight point of view to a more nuanced point of view, or however you would even frame that transition?
With extreme difficulty, frankly. You know what I mean? That's not done easily. As any parent of an ROGD kid will say, this is not done easily. And, you know, with anybody, you know, who has been deep in the trenches of any sort of mental illness, and it's so trite to say it, but if you don't get buy-in from the person who is in it, it's almost impossible to pull them out. You know what I mean? Like, there's plenty of people who stay in cults. Mm-hmm. There's plenty of people who stay in mental illness. They don't come out. You know what I mean? And I'm not saying they're the same thing, but there's a mindset that is very similar. And to you know, the only people who generally pull out is because they're unhappy. Because, mm-hmm. you know what I mean? Because it's not working, and they have the bravery and the courage. Why some people don't pull out and some people do, nobody has figured that out. It's not the depth of the illness, though. Do you know what I mean? But some people just don't.
Mm-hmm.
Of anything, they just don't. Nobody's figured that out. The best psychologist in the world hasn't figured out why would that person pull out of it and that person hasn't. What is the difference? It's the million-dollar question. And I don't think... However, they do say it's commitment to change. But why are some people committed to change and some people aren't, if you follow me? You can when it gets up and running, you can see. I could see it very quickly if I was faced with two people and I got to know them quite quickly. I could say, yeah, this person mm-hmm. is more likely to come out than this person. And I'll give you reasons, but it will generally be a kind of a commitment. I have got it between my teeth and I'm not backing down. I am coming out of this. Now, the other person might have the same and they might get the same words, but it can feel slightly different in the room with them. But why is one person much more committed than the other? I just don't think anybody has figured that out.
Yeah,
and that's going to be a really interesting question because, there's what is the difference between somebody who leaves a cult and somebody who gets left by a cult? Like, if kind of the cult that is like the gender cult implodes, I feel much better about the prospects of the people who had the wherewithal or the resources or the courage or the push or whatever it took to leave than for the people who are going to be left behind.
However, a really interesting kind of development since, you know, Jen Specht have been working on this Beyond Transition program,
working
a lot of detransitioners. A really interesting turn up for the books that I didn't expect was an awful lot of people who've left behind gender ideology were forced to it because of their medical problems. That first came the problems, then came a kind of falling of the scales and a kind of readjustment. I didn't expect it to be that way around, if you follow me. So that's... Yeah. Very interesting.
So you're saying detransitioners who develop some sort of condition due to the transition that facilitates? Okay.
Yeah, I've noticed that too, because some of my research is on, it's like half on trans communities and half on detrans communities. And it's like the reasons that people detransition were like, it was medical complications was a big one.
Huge.
And that it like, that is something that can drive a wedge between a person and a belief system.
Yeah.
And then the others were things like, for a lot of young women, it was either experiencing like sexual violence or sexual coercion, or like not realizing you're not escaping kind of sexual dynamics that you were really uncomfortable with. And then people who just realize that it's like, it's not working. And what that usually sounds like is somebody who says, you know, it's not, maybe it's still desirable if it were possible to fully transition and to be the opposite sex. But what is available, like, it's not enough, and it's never going to be enough, and it's not, like, I can't live my life pretending.
Yeah.
And, like, those are the three things that I see over and over again.
Me too. Exactly those.
Hmm. So, you know, it's kind of a trope or something that people in this sphere say that there's just going to be more and more detransitioners mm-hmm. as time goes on. And that's going to be true as more and more people transition, more and more people will detransition. But there's also data that I kind of glimpsed at where less and less people who are trans are actually doing any sort of medical.
I'm all for that.
I'd be interested in what both of you think. I think, go on, knock yourselves out, you know. He, him, all over the place, and do you know what I mean? Wear whatever you want, and okay.
Yeah.
You know, and I know binders are damaging, and I know they're very, very damaging to the body, but they're not as damaging as medical interventions. Yeah. And the medical interventions are really, really distressing. So I'm all for, yeah, queer your identity if that's what you want to do. If that is what is needed to get us out of this kind of pretense that medicalization is the only way we can deal with any sort of gender distress. Mm-hmm. Well, all right.
Yeah. But then you still have the political ideology that insists on its totalitarian.
There's a great phrase in activism, which is, you know, accept compromise and keep fighting. Yeah. And I do stand by that. You know, yeah, it's a compromise. It's, you know, I've still plenty more to say about the ideology. That's it. That's the end of that. Let's move on. But I would say, yeah, that's a step forward.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm with Stella. I think the fewer costs that individuals sink into it, the better. I think the less medicalized it is, the better. And I also think from a political perspective, like, the ideology is still toxic, it still hurts women's rights, but the more the face of like transgender, the more the face of the trans movement becomes, you know, men with beards and penises, the easier it's going to be to push back politically on the ideology, I think.
Yeah. What we did with in GenSpec, so WPAT, their idea is to promote transgender healthcare, and that means medicalization in their work. Well, GenSpec's concept is to promote a healthy approach to sex and gender. Mm-hmm. And so a healthy approach accepts that, you know, if some people want to do various things to go through an exploration of where they're at, well, that's healthy enough. It's not perfectly healthy, but few of us are. And so, you know, you can move towards health in lots of different ways.
Yeah, I think that that's the perfect frame to oppose what's going on at WPATH. Because they have adopted and propagated this incredibly narrow definition of what it means to provide care to people who are distressed about gender and confused about gender. And I mean, having been to that conference and having read all of the papers and seen all of these talks, it's like they have an idea of care that's completely divorced from being curious about the people that they're purportedly caring for. And I don't think that there is any such thing as providing care without being curious about what's going on with someone on a deep level.
They're laughably, I shouldn't say laughably, but they're terribly unconcerned with the holistic individual. Yeah. And just like the phallus works or it doesn't, the urination or the orgasm potential, and it's completely fragmenting the individual. I don't know if you know, Benjamin, but when we have this conference in Killarney at the end of April, Eliza's going to go to the EPATH conference as well. Yeah. And she'll have her dispatches from EPATH and then go rushing.
Stella, are you going?
Yeah, all three of us will be there.
No, will you be at EPATH?
Oh, yeah. Oh, I'll be. But I won't be as forensic as you will be.
Okay, no, I'm just so glad that you'll be there.
I can't wait. I can't wait to see what EPATH is like. But I think I will be, when I say I can't wait, I just want to see it because I think I'll get within very quickly because I've seen it online, that very clinical, like I say, and now we will look at the, you know, musculature or we will look at the jawline. God, they have no, and like Alistair spoke so lovely about it, you know, he's had this cancer diagnosis, but they look at the impact on his life, which is normal medical treatment. Well, we might give you this, but this will impact that. So we'll have a look at the holistic individual. They don't do that at all. It's just zeroing in. It's like something out of a different century.
Well, it is. And it's also, I mean, I think a lot of psychopharmaceuticals, there's a kind of a similar approach within medicine where it's like, oh, this patient is depressed and they need Prozac. And it's like, okay, but, you know, maybe they just were widowed or, you know, there's like this cutting out the context. So I don't think that that's unique to gender medicine, but I think that it's like the belief that people are really trans and the transportation of like, the basis for action in medicine from like a realm of testimony from a realm of evidence to a realm of testimony, that it just completely, it's like nothing else matters about the patient and nothing else matters about their history because they're just transgender. And I've been reading Hannah Barnes' book, The Time to Think. Have you guys gotten it yet?
Oh yeah, I've read it. I reviewed it.
You reviewed it. Okay. And it's interesting to, like, it's a fascinating book. So far, I haven't come across anything that I wasn't already aware of, but there's something about seeing it just, you know, like one hit after the other.
That is incredibly.
The National Health Service and the Tavistock Clinic, and their work with kids. And it's a particular focus on, like, puberty blockers and kids. And at the same time that I'm reading it, and I'm really feeling like, oh my God, because you're reading about, you know, the 2000, the inquiry and all of the past patients of the Tavistock, and how many of those kids had been in care, and how many of them had lost a parent, and how many of them had lost a sibling, and how overrepresented all of those kinds of losses were. And yet Barnes is writing in such an even-handed way that I can imagine reading it as somebody who might, you know, be a member of WPATH, and that they would be like, okay, maybe, like, you know, 25% of these kids had a foster care experience as opposed to, like, less than 1% of the general population, but, like, they were just, you know, they're just transgender. Like, it just doesn't matter.
Well, it fixes everything. If somebody was to have OCD, and if the OCD treatment was medical surgery in their brain or something, and people said, well, they're OCD. It is who they are. It's so, I suppose, religious or something, if you follow me.
Yeah.
Transgender. You know, they are OCD or something like that. It's like, that's not how we perceive any other condition. You know what I mean? It's all roads lead back to the belief of a gender identity. All roads do.
Yeah. And still, it's something that I literally have thought about it every single day since this episode was posted, was that conversation that you and Sasha had with the Dutch clinicians. And I'm sure you think about it all the time too, but it was just the way that they thought about their work and the ways that they dealt with the possibility that they had done harm, and the way that they, and maybe most of all, just like the incredibly low expectations that they had for their patients and the kind of lives that their patients would have is, I think, the thing that I just can't get over.
I think that is the thing that angered most people by that awful but terrible but good episode of our podcast, was they really had very low estimation and expectations of these children who were young, but they were basically saying, here, like, what are you going to get out of them? Like, as for the idea that they might have children, like, you know, get real there, Stella. Like,
or that they might have happy relationships, or that they might be comfortable in their bodies that were surgically altered because they weren't comfortable in their bodies. It was just, it was unreal to hear that.
All you could think is that, you know, I love, you know, what would you be like if it happened to your own family there?
Right.
You know what I mean? How would they have reacted? They were a very good example of the WPATH outlook, which is a medical problem because they have this gender identity within them. We will just put things on them medically, and some of them will work, some of them won't. But frankly, they were born with this transgenderism.
Yeah.
And so we're just mitigating, really.
Okay.
Yeah.
So back to the earlier in the conversation, with the radicalization and the violence, the increasing amount of violence in the name of thwarting a trans genocide. Do you guys understand what that concept, a trans genocide, like, what does that mean?
Mm-hmm.
I guess it's context dependent, and it is histrionic, and why am I erasing somebody's existence? Like, why is there and what does it mean to be a trans genocider? Like, what are you doing? Is it just the pronouns thing, or is it like not allowing children access to this life-saving medical care? Is that what it means?
Well, I'm dying to hear what Eliza say. I'll just give my tuppence worth. When I first heard that, I thought, that's just stupid. What are they talking about? This trans genocide, it makes no sense. Erasing my right to exist is all, it was really irritatingly stupid for me at first, right? I've kind of since moved on from irritatingly stupid to going, oh, so they think, this is where I believe it comes from, mm-hmm. they think if I don't believe in gender identity, I have erased them. Because mm-hmm. it'd be like me saying, I don't believe in Christianity, so I'm erasing Christianity in my mind. Therefore, I don't believe in who, and there is something in that. I don't believe in a gender identity. Mm-hmm. So you could argue, therefore, well, I am erasing the concept of a gender identity. So I feel a little bit more at peace of where they're going with this extraordinary hyperbolic language that mm-hmm. isn't appropriate and is incredibly incendiary.
Yeah. I mean, it seems like a lot of concepts within like the kind of trans belief system, it operates in several different ways. And there's kind of like, you know, the Mott and the Bailey, there's the defensible position. And then there's the one that they, you know, usually
retreat to.
When they're challenged, they retreat to the defensible position.
Yeah. Like 40% of suicides or something.
Yeah. The defensible position is, I think it's exactly what Stella says, where it's like, if you don't, you're erasing the existence of trans people if you don't buy into this belief system and you're saying that they don't really exist. It's kind of like, you know, the Tinkerbell effect, where it's like, okay, clap if you believe in fairies and Tinkerbell will live. And then there's the other side of that is like, if the claim is that denying surgical interventions and puberty blockers and hormones to kids is causing suicide, like I think that is the other part of it, that it's like genocide via suicide.
Oh yeah.
But they will, when not challenged about transgenocide, they will kind of move to a much broader claim. And the way that it's talked about on Reddit, for example, is that they will often talk about like the possibility of, they'll say that it's, you know, Germany in 1933 and that there will be death camps and that they're keeping lists of trans people and that trans people will be dragged off and that there needs to be a movement for trans people to arm themselves. And so there's this, it's like transgenocide has these different meanings to different groups at different times based on who's asking. And the really terrifying and the really, I think, the one that really licenses what might be thought of as like retributive or vengeful violence is the one where it's like people are going to come and drag trans people from their homes and send them to death camps, just like the Nazis.
Which, may I say, like, I'm very worried, not that that is going to happen, but I am very worried right. about the bills are going in the US, mm-hmm. the red and the blue. It's so sledgehammer to crack a nut, if you follow me, and yeah. both sides. It looks, from my side of the world in Ireland, I look at these bills going, whoa, they are mad, both sides. I don't think either of them are good. I think they're really heavy-handed laws, depending whether it's a red state or a blue state in America. And I don't know. I know there's a lovely law, not law, but there's a lovely bill that Genspec supports, which I think is brilliant. But I'll tell you about it in a sec. But the extreme kind of banning affirmative therapy and banning this, and then on the other side, kind of taking children off parents if you're not affirmative. And this kind of weird slide of affirmative therapy, apparently parents can be conversion therapists. It's like, sorry, what? Parents are parents. They're not therapists. What is all this? The crazy slide mm-hmm. of language. But the bill that Genspec is kind of into, which I think is really good, and I want to make it a kind of one of our campaigning kind of wings, is around the line that whatever company insures medical transition also has to ensure the secondary complications related to medical transition mm-hmm. and the detransition process. So proper insurance, comprehensive insurance for medical transition, rather than this two-bit half-baked mm-hmm. affair that they have now. Now, I like that because that's kind of, you know, baked in reality and its consequences, and insurance companies will bite their lip with that because they'll realize there's a mass of secondary complications, let alone the cost of detransition.
I wonder what the pipeline is pressure-wise of, if you pressure the insurance, then that'll change the, because I think top of my list is these medical organizations, you know, the APA, all the different all these different organizations. They need to change, and then the standards of care will change later on down the road. But if they are incentivized through insurance to change, if they aren't given free, it seems like this affirmative care is going through from the top down because there's just license to do this because they can just do this because of the insurance is allowing to do this. And then the laws in the states are kind of out here somewhere.
I think some of the strategies through the legal system and through insurance changes have a lot of potential, like what Stella's talking about, where it's like, count more of these costs when you're covering this care. And also some of the bills in red states have included a provision that I do really support, which is to expand kind of the ability for patients who were harmed by this care to sue for medical malpractice. And I think that has a lot of potential to maybe scare clinicians back into line to think about an individual patient and be like, is this person really going to benefit, or are they going to show up on my doorstep in 5 years with a lawsuit?
Is that a state law, or is that?
I think it's been in a couple of different states, and
I can't remember
where it just went through.
So basically, at the moment, some of the statute of limitations is extraordinarily short. It feels purposefully short because it doesn't make sense. And so the time of regret is generally 5 to 7 years. You know, it's a long game. Well, I say that off the top of my head, we have very little evidence, but you follow me, it's long. And what we need is kind of the space for somebody who's medically transitioned to come around a few years later to be able to say, actually, you caused me damage. I was in a very vulnerable state. I had tried suicide. I had already panic disorder. I had a huge amount of issues. And you medically transitioned me inappropriately. And now I have to sue you. They can't do that now. And, you know, Scott Nugent really kind of explored that. And he said it's really impossible right now in some states to sue. It's too short for starters. Yeah.
So I think that has a lot of potential. And I'm interested in, and I'm not like a legal expert, but I'm interested in kind of the challenges to are what we would call these cosmetic procedures to, you know, perform surgery and to give people hormones. Like, is it medicine or not? And like, should it be covered by medical insurance or not? And like, that's definitely been a part of what's going on in Florida, is that question of like, is it medicine? Do we pay for this?
Is a boob job medicine? It's a medical procedure, but is it medicine?
I don't know. What is it?
Maybe a reduction for back pain, I understand, has a medical purpose to it, but an aesthetic. I guess so. The argument, like, there's these medical procedures that are for aesthetic purposes.
Yeah, the argument would be kind of reinstating, like, reclassifying transition as cosmetic interventions.
Question. That would complicate the trans thing. And I think that would be more. Though.
It really would, but it's also like, I think that it's much more honest to say, like, we can help you to imitate the opposite sex, but, you know, the evidence isn't there. It's not a treatment for dysphoria. It's sure not a cure.
No.
And the people who are, in my experience, the people who are happiest with transition are the people who didn't go in thinking that it was medicine.
Yeah.
And didn't go in thinking it was going to change their sex.
Yeah.
And I think with the people who've been really harmed that I've talked to, the fact that these things were offered under the banner of medicine was part of the harm, and it was part of the reassurance when they weren't sure that they were doing the right thing.
That right?
Yeah, that seems really big to me.
Yeah.
There's also a strange little quirk in this, and I don't know, but it sounds like for such a huge movement, a huge medical movement, there's just such a dearth of data. There's such a lack of data. Yeah. It seems like it would be nice if it seems, but maybe there's other like pockets of the medical industry where they don't gather terribly a lot of data.
In fairness, I don't know. Now, Eliza might know better than me here, but my feeling was it was so niche and so small. There was just a small number of, medics who were involved in it. There was a small number of psychologists, there was a small number of endocrinologists, small number of gender people, that it was very small, very, very niche, and nobody was, there was very little research there for. I'm sure there's very little research for emetophobia or, you know, one of those very small, kind of small, not many people know about it. And now there will be tons. I think in 10 years, there's going to be an awful lot of research about this.
I don't know.
Oh, do you know?
Well, I mean, I think when I started digging into the gender stuff, I was like, it's got to be this absolute exception to the way that medical practice is operating. And the more that I branched out into kind of other diagnoses and other kind of psychopharmaceuticals and other procedures, it was like, oh, this has pretty, like, this is maybe the most intense concentration of problems that can be found across medicine, and especially across like mental health care. Because I mean, things like the research on gender being really poor, with a really short follow-up time, with no control groups, with things like that, like that's really common for psychopharmaceutical research. And you can do something like with antidepressants, where you know, the researchers argue that it's unethical to have a control group because you'd be withholding this treatment that they've decided in advance is life-saving. That is exactly the same rationale that comes up in gender.
Yeah, you're actually embarrassingly right about all the psychopharmaceuticals. You're right.
It's a lot like those things, even though this is like much more insane.
Yeah. There is many, many, many more research, but a lot of the research is arguably quite shoddy. Where you go, sorry, you know, it's not great. The research for psychopharmaceuticals isn't great. Yeah, weirdly enough, I wasn't thinking of my own industry. I was thinking of, I don't know, cardiac and cancer.
Yeah, I think it is really different from like cardiac and cancer, but I just don't think it's that different from like psychiatry. And I mean, there's even like there are detransition, quote unquote, problems with like the psychopharmaceuticals, where you have people who want to get off of, you know, who end up taking psychopharmaceuticals for a long time, or they don't like the changes that are happening to them, or they just want to try to live without them, or they're having like polypharmacy problems where they're taking a whole bunch of drugs to manage symptoms. And those people, much like detransitioners, are in this no man's land where nobody knows, you know, kind of the consequences of the care that they've been given, how to taper off. And I don't think that the problems of like demonization for people who want to stop are quite the same, but the lack of supports is very similar.
Yeah, I remember working with a client, and she was in the, you know, she was taking more than 20 pills a day.
Oh my God.
Slowly reduced, and it all began with postpartum depression, postnatal depression, you know, and it just built upon. It was just an extraordinary story. I do remember that she did. She reduced massively, massively. You know what I mean? But I did see how little support, and it was very like, I know what you're talking about with the detransition. Nobody quite knew the impact of coming down off slowly but surely in a methodical way. But nobody, she was on her own doing her own thing, her own procedure. Yeah. And it was a shocking thing to watch. Now, it did end well, but it was a shocking. I was kind of a witness to something that it gave me an insight into that industry of, wow, they're in territory. But I remember somebody saying, and I thought it was an interesting point, they said, you know, the origin of the trans kid wasn't, you know, queer theory. It was more like Ritalin in the 90s, giving all children antidepressants and Ritalin, psychoactive substances, to make them more happy, more dealable with, more whatever, was more of a precursor than the, you know, the highfalutin queer theory.
Okay, the trans kid concept is based more on the ADHD kid concept plus the trans ideology, plus the gay rights and then the pride stuff, like being projected.
Yeah, but it's like you define this group of kids as having a medical problem, and then you medicate them, and you don't have a plan for, you know, is it a phase? Is it the environment? How do we stop this? What happens if we keep them on it?
What's the long-term impact?
Right. What's the long-term impact? I mean, like,
I remember, you know, Kurt Cobain and what was her name? Courtney Love talking about being put on. And I'm not always against substances. I think for some people, oh my God, they are life-changing. I do want to say that, and I've seen that. But I remember Kurt Cobain and Courtney Love, they were both put on something like Ritalin as kids, and they said the impact was, they both, according to them, was that they turned to drugs.
Yeah.
As adults, I can see where they were going. That was our solution from a very young age. Whereas the drugs make me happier.
Yeah.
Yeah. It just,
and there's also, no. Oh, sorry.
You.
Oh, I was going to say, like, another kind of like psychopharmaceutical legacy that we see, you know, played out to an extreme with gender is this making a diagnosis into an identity, which is something that psychopharmaceutical marketing had been trying to do. And I think the best example that I'm aware of is like the marketing of bipolar disorder in the 1990s, where it was like they have these kind of atypical antipsychotics. They want to grow the market. They see a lot of potential, and they need to sell a diagnosis to the public, because in the US in the late 90s, direct-to-consumer advertising for these kinds of psychopharmaceuticals opens up, and they also want to sell it to doctors. And what they do with bipolar disorder is, you know, they find academics, they find people with like a compelling, you know, celebrities, people with a compelling personal story. They go back and they pull people out of the past and they diagnose them the way that we trans people now. So, and they sell bipolar disorder as this, like, you know, this stroke of genius wrapped in dysfunction, so that it's something where you can, like, you have the permission and excuse of like, okay, this is what's wrong with me. This is why I can't get my marriage. This is why I'm not doing well at work. But I'm also like this special kind of genius person. And bipolar diagnoses, bipolar medication just goes through the roof.
What's a bipolar med? I still don't understand what bipolar is. It's like borderline. It's like, what are you talking about? Like, I have an image in my head, but it has nothing to do with
it. What they're mostly selling, it's kind of like a mix of antidepressants and antipsychotics for manic phases.
Like a speedball. Okay. Or an inverse speedball. Coke and heroin.
Yeah, but it's like, but they're totally selling it as an identity to sell drugs.
Have you spoken to Bob Ostertag yet, either of you?
I haven't spoken to him, but I've read his book and I listened to your interview.
It's very interesting. And he said that in the 90s, like up until the 90s, there wasn't the concept that female equals estrogen and male equals testosterone. You know what I mean? And back then in the 80s and pre the 80s, sex change was changing your genitals, and there was no talk of testosterone and estrogen. And then they started marketing the essence of woman is estrogen, the essence of man is testosterone. And this was a marketed branding success that we now think filled with testosterone equals male, filled with estrogen. And he's right. He's technically right. Like, as I'm plenty of estrogen, but I have progesterone. I have other things in me. They've just ticked in on one. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I have testosterone in me. And also, if you gave Benjamin, way more testosterone, you'll grow breasts. Your penis will shrink. Like, it's not very male if you give it to you. So he was very clever about that, Bob Ostertag. It was like, it gave me a whole understanding of, in the 90s, they marketed essence of man and essence of women. Mm-hmm. And they had had it since the 30s. They'd had testosterone and estrogen on their shelves, and they hadn't done much with it. All through that kind of, you know, there was a bit of a sex change kind of push in the 60s and 70s. There was a lot of, with Harry Benjamin and all that kind of, they didn't talk about testosterone and estrogen. It hadn't been marketed as male or female.
I thought that was so interesting when he was talking about, like, the things that we think about as side effects of testosterone, because they're not masculinizing. Like, exactly what you said, where, like, if a man grows breasts, if a man's penis shrinks, like, that's just a side effect. And it's like, no, that's testosterone.
That's testosterone for Benjamin.
Sorry, Benjamin.
That's fine. Sex isn't a spectrum, but the endocrine system is. It's a big cocktail.
Yeah, I'm sure, and he was so good on the entanglement of like medical technologies and identity. And I think that he was just so sensitive in the way that he raised that, where he was like, we don't have to question, you know, we have to be able to talk about this interaction between medical technology and our ideas about ourselves. And it can't be that it's too threatening to people's identity to talk about it, because it really matters. And I think that was just something that he did really well. Like, he did it really compassionately.
Yeah, I thought so too. I think he's brilliant. At the risk of overdoing talking about our lovely conference in Killarney, that's, I think, what's really special about what we're doing. So EPATH, WPATH will be down the road in Killarney talking about just one thing, which is the medical identity of gender. While up the road, GensPACT will be talking about the, you know, the psychological, the sociological, the cultural, the environmental, medical, the, you know, the legal, the educational. So the entire concept of gender identity, rather than this play acting that it's just a medical issue. I'm stunned that it hasn't been done before, but now I'm thrilled that we're doing it.
I think it's so brilliant.
Yeah. My God, it all needs to be married. Helen Joyce needs to meet with Ken Zucker. Do you know what I mean? Keeping these off in silos is farcical. This is
salon.
It's got many different layers that need all be brought together. So people are thinking, oh, I didn't think of this. Oh, yeah, the legal aspect needs to be thought of when we think of the cultural aspect. They can't have, you know, feminists over here and lawyers over here. They need to meet and think.
Yeah.
The plan. Yeah.
That's the plan. I think it's amazing because at WPATH, it was just like there was this just missing layer that was like the human layer in between the abstraction of like we're the forces of good fighting the forces of evil, the forces of transphobia, and then like the surgical technique level. And there was just nothing in the middle and there was no curiosity. And it was just, there was something that was really inhuman about it. And I wonder like the extent to which, did other people feel that? Who were attending that conference? Like, did they feel that that was missing?
Did you think they did? You were there.
I mean, it was so hard to tell. Like, you could tell that people were uneasy about different things. But it was very hard to tell. Like, the other thing is that I think WPATH and I think the gender affirming approach offers clinicians and patients and parents, like, it offers them substitutes for the things that it kind of cuts out. And what I mean by that is like, so we were talking about how do you have care without having curiosity a few minutes ago, and that you need curiosity about a patient and like how they got here to provide good care. And WPATH doesn't have curiosity about, you know, life history and developmental stage and all of those things that we would say really, really matter when it comes to figuring out, you know, where does this gender dysphoria, where does this transgender identity come from? But I think that clinicians feel like they are being curious because they're really curious about, you know, tell me about your gender identity and all of the different, you know, permutations in the gender universe. Like, they're offered this kind of substitute curiosity that's not clinical.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Should this type of phalloplasty or that type?
Right, right. And they're offered this kind of like facsimile of a debate. And so they're like, well, there's not no debate. Like, we're debating, you know, should you be 16 or should you be 17 when you have a phalloplasty? And should you go from puberty blockers to cross-sex hormones, or should you just start kids on cross-sex hormones right away? Like, they have these kind of little like pseudo or surrogate debates and surrogate concepts. Like, I mean, the biggest surrogate concept is probably this whole like the true self, right? And this idea of authenticity that they talk about all the time, so that nobody ever has to say like what's authentic about changing everything about yourself. So I think WPATH and gender-affirming care buy off a lot of clinicians' reservations by offering these kinds of substitutes. And then I think, like, WPATH was a huge, like, it had a real, like, a re-education camp vibe because it was just full of suggestions about how to manage unease that a practitioner might feel. And everything in it kind of conspired against a practitioner who wants to see the whole picture of what's going on with a patient, because it would be like, well, if you feel uncomfortable, like maybe you're not qualified because you're cisgender, and maybe you need to check your privilege, and maybe you need to educate yourself, and maybe you need to listen to more trans narratives, and maybe you need to withhold judgment, and maybe you need to, you know, think really flexibly, and maybe you need to follow the patient. And it's like,
wow.
I think that there's a sense that something is wrong, and there's this like, it's something that you have a moral responsibility as a clinician to overcome.
Fascinating.
And I would be so curious how many people from WPATH take up the offer from GensPACT to like bring us your ticket and you get in for free.
Come on, we will give you a prize seats.
Yeah.
So, Benjamin, just so you know, if you go to the EBATH conference, you're welcome into the Gentlemen conference for free, and we'd be delighted. Genuinely, I was being funny there, but
Yes.
truly, and so I do know some are coming. I do know some people, some clinicians who are attending and speaking at EBATH are coming to Genspect, and they're right. You know, our first night we'll be having a panel of detransitioners. Any clinician who works in gender should be all about it. The
Yeah.
detransitioners are effectively the black box of, the airplane industry. You really absolutely need to dissect what's happened to any detransitioner, and when you've got a panel of them, it's a brilliant opportunity to make sure you do less harm.
Yeah.
Yeah, that
Yeah.
should be their kind of warning: do less harm.
Yeah, do less harm. Think
That's
about
a
this belief
beginning,
system
yeah,
that lets
right.
you do like what?
Well, it's a beginning to get them back to do no harm, right? Give
Yeah,
them like,
that's accepting
yeah.
compromises and keep fighting. Do less harm. In 2023, do less harm. And then 2024, we might move to something better.
Yeah. And it's like, just think about this belief system that lets you do unlimited harm to your patients while you think that you're doing good. Like, just think about it. And maybe,
You're right.
yeah, maybe the GenSpec conference can. Maybe the GenSpec conference can give clinicians the space that I often think that like patients and young people who identify as trans need, which is a space to be uncertain about things and a space to have questions and a space where it's like, WPATH's atmosphere, and I don't know if EPATH will be like this, although my guess would be that it will be, is like, we can't afford nuance right now. And like that is the and or this fear that like no matter what they say, they will be misunderstood. And so our critics can't be trusted to see what we do in the right light. And they're going to look at, there's this risk that if journalists report on it, if other clinicians challenge it, if researchers follow up with patients, like people are going to see what we're doing in the wrong light. And they're going to look at, don't know, like they're going to, some of this has come up around like misinformation and disinformation in the gender conversation. And so it will be like if somebody says, okay, top surgeries for like trans mask boys are happening. And if somebody says breast amputations for like adolescent natal females are like, that's not happening. But it's the same thing. So it's misinformation. It's labeled misinformation, even if it's happening, if it leads people to the wrong conclusion, with the wrong conclusion being like, maybe something's going wrong here. And the right conclusion being, this is really life-saving care, and it's great that we're providing surgeries for teenagers.
Is there
Yeah.
you said that there's a lack of curiosity, but do you get a sense of like a morbid fascination? Like kind of like a like kind of that sounds a little sinister, and maybe it is a little sinister, but still that human need to know, that human need to
Yeah.
master, that Frankensteinian zeitgeist.
I mean, I think that those are kind of different things, right? Because one of them is about the identity of the provider. And maybe you have like that providing transgender care, it's not just about the identity of the patient, it's the provider like wants to think of themselves as a helper or maybe a miracle worker or maybe a savior.
Yeah.
And I think that that's definitely going on. I don't know about the morbid fascination. What do you think, Stella?
Yeah, I think it's a really good question, and I agree with you that the savior instinct, especially in people in my industry, psychologically, we have not covered ourselves in glory again and again and again over the decades with this savior instinct. It's awful. But this morbid fascination, there are a couple of contenders, you could argue, Norman Spack, and there's a couple of that kind of seem to get overexcited
That's
about.
true.
Yeah, he was foaming at the mouth when he first heard of puberty blockers, and I'm only quoting him. That's what he said. So one could say that sounds like an over-the-top fascination. But I don't feel that's a driver, and I know other people will. I feel it's more about savior and feeling that self-importance. I'm at the beginning of a movement. I'm
Yeah.
saving. I'm part of the zeitgeist. The self-importance of that, I think, and also I'm part of something special. It's also special. I think that's more. It's more mundane than that. You know that. Maybe I shouldn't make the equivalence, but the banality of evil,
Yeah.
that It's so powerful. I think there is a lot to it. I think it's a really powerful essay.
Yeah.
There was one video I saw of a guy going on about phalloplasty of some sort, but he was talking about how they can grow an ear in a vat. They can get your DNA or skin graft or some sort of graft, and then they can grow your flesh around this wired, you know, this wired construct, and then it'll be your ear, and you can have your new ear. We could probably do that with the penis, right? And he was like, we have these molds, you know, and like this structure will just like, we'll grow you a penis.
Isn't there a part of medicine that get very excited by what is to come, whether it's medical technology and what we can do? And honestly, that's just a curious brain that is just stretching their, you know, their industry in a very kind of in their own, you know, just what we can do, whether we should do it or not is for the moralists. It's just, what can we actually do? It's like, can we put somebody to the moon? Now, can we go to Mars? Can we go to Pluto? You know what I mean? Anybody who's really into their craft might want to see how far can you go with anything.
Yeah.
And there's that. That seems to be strong among the surgeons and the
I think that's a huge part of it. I mean, it's whether it's, can we make this virus more transmissible?
Yeah.
Without asking whether, you know, that's a smart thing to do. And then the surgeries, like, there is this excitement and this confusion, I think, between advancement of medical technology and progress, and that those aren't necessarily the same thing.
Yeah. And that's tricky.
Yeah.
Tricky, tricky, tricky subject.
Yeah. And that's where you need the whole picture to see if it's a good thing or if it's a bad thing.
Yeah. It feels no accident that that kind of the whole euthanasia and all that has kind of got very over the top in places like Canada. And you could see this is more what can we do and what should we do meeting in really obvious ways.
Eliza, what are you going to do with your work once you're no longer in a master's program? Are you going to go into a doctorate, or are you going to turn into some sort of globe-trotting journalist?
I don't know. I haven't decided about the PhD. I've been working on a book proposal, and we'll kind of see what happens with that.
Woo-hoo, great.
And Stella, you said something that made me really nervous this week.
Oh, crap. Did I?
Yeah, you were tweeting about your new book, which we should talk about. But you said that the easy part was writing the book.
Oh, yeah.
So that made me really worried.
My new book is behind me there, Benjamin. We haven't given it enough attention, what your teen is trying to tell you. And it's about mental health and teenagers. And yeah, I stand by what I tweeted earlier on.
No!
Which was very heartfelt, which is, I love writing books. It's a pleasure. It's my happy place. No matter what's going on in life, give me the computer and let me just churn out ideas and thoughts around psychology and mental health. Very definitely where I'm happiest. But launching it and, oh my God, marketing it and talking about it and saying this is why you should buy it. And oh my God, it's draining. Now, Eliza, you don't have to do it. You know, you don't have to do it. Not everybody does it. You know, you can...
Yeah.
And you can go a different way with it, but yeah, it's draining.
Ultimately. Yeah.
I want to see Eliza on Oprah. I really want to see you on Oprah, Eliza.
Oh, God.
You go all the way, go the distance, do it.
Is Oprah still going?
I don't know
about that. I don't think I've ever seen an episode, but somebody actually mentioned like a really brilliant idea for a book, which was like to follow up with all of the kind of like pseudoscience that Oprah has promoted over the years.
Oh, wow.
I've never seen an episode, but I would love to read that book.
You've never
probably
seen
do
an
episode?
Yeah.
Probably do a whole YouTube channel just going through debunking Oprah.
Oh, my God.
Great title.
Yeah.
Debunking Oprah.
Yeah.
It's like, sounds just like Deepak Chopra, doesn't it? Didn't she launch him? I can't remember. I don't know.
I don't know.
Yeah. So you got that book coming out, or it's out. So,
it's out.
Is it out or is it?
What's it about? What your train is trying to tell you?
And teenagers. Let me just get it. My lovely new
Oh, wow, that's
book.
big.
I'm suddenly fond of it. I was dreading it. It was like a kind of a snake in my house the last few weeks because I was so, I have to launch it and I just want to just shrivel up and die. But now it's out, I'm fond of it. A little baby. It's about mental health in teenagers and basically how parents often, and I can see why they do, but they often charge the child off to the psychotherapist without first maybe leaning in themselves and saying, what's mm-hmm. going on for you? Because I think an awful lot of parents have been disempowered and they're frightened of mental health. And they're frightened of their teenagers' mental health. And so rather than saying, what's happening? You seem to be lost. Parents, you know, love their children. They're the world expert of their children. They love their children more than anybody else. They're more committed. And yet they're disempowering themselves and they're creating this triangulation of, you know, therapist, teenager, and parent. And the therapist is the savior, the teenager is the poor victim, and the parent is the persecutor. It's a very common, it's, you know, the drama triangle. It's mm-hmm. very bad for everybody, and it's particularly bad for the parent who's been disempowered. Like, I remember one teenager, and she was my friend, but the mother was told, the teenager was told, whenever you're stressed, play music really loud in your room. And so she did at 4 a.m. And so the mother comes up saying, sorry, we've got other people in the house. There's children in the house. And the teenager's like, my therapist told me.
Oh, no.
Yeah. And that's the triangulation. So what I'm trying to say is empower the parents to say, listen, man, you've probably got it. You probably know as much as this therapist. This idea of these therapists behind the green curtain in The Wizard of Oz doing our woo-woo has been incredibly destructive. And I, as a psychotherapist, want to open up that curtain and say, honestly, Benjamin, what you could do, or Eliza, what you could do if you had kids would be often as good, if not better, than what a mm-hmm. therapist. Now, I'm not saying sometimes somebody's had an awful trauma and maybe they need therapists, but a huge amount of teenagers could probably benefit from less bringing in the professionals and more just read up a little bit about the specific issue. It's there's nothing magical going on in a therapist's office.
So your book provides a roadmap for just tips and tricks on how to be a parent and what how to read signs and
kind of not more like it's like almost nearly a manual that you could dip into. So if there was OCD or if there was panic or if there was eating disorders or body image problems or gender problems or whatever, that you'd be able to read that bit of the book and feel a bit more, okay, I know my kid, I know her anyway. Mm-hmm. Now I know a little bit about this and I can handle it. That's the kind of, do you know what I mean? And you can read more, but it certainly gives you a good psychological understanding of the issue at hand.
Yeah.
So you can parent as you want, you know, we all parent in different ways, but just to give you a bit of a psychological understanding. That's the grand concept anyway. Anyway, now it's launched. Thank God I'm on the other side, but don't let that put you off, Eliza, man. You gotta stretch your.
No, I won't let it put me out, but it was kind of one of those like. I love the conversation that you had with Sasha last week, just about your book and about the, just the mission to kind of re-empower parents to connect with your kids.
Yeah. Well, and working in the general, you see that they're so disempowered. It's frightening.
Yeah. It's like you've never known your child because you were wrong that your child was a girl or a boy.
Yeah.
Like on the most basic level, it's disempowering of parents.
Dreadful.
And contemptuous, and like really contemptuous of that relationship.
Dismissive.
Yeah.
So many things have been so dismissed and ostracized. It's awful what's happened. Yeah. There's going to be a great book out by the parents. Books coming every month now. There's books coming on gender. I'm telling you, we'll be coming down with books.
Parents' books?
Yeah. What is the parent book?
Going to be a book kind of, I'm not going to give too much away in case I shouldn't be talking about it, but there's going to be a book about parents' accounts of what happened to them. And we all know, anybody who knows this world knows, a whole kind of chapter when this history is written will be on the miscarriage of justice that happened to those parents and those families.
Yeah.
We should probably wrap up now. It's late for Stella. I'm sure, Eliza, you have like 500,000 words to write. What's your average? You like 2,000 words a day? Like, what's your...
I don't know.
You don't count. You don't have like a
quota.
I'm not
a quantitative person.
Oh, you're not a quantitative person. Okay.
What's the book about? Is it kind of the culture of gender? Or are we allowed to ask?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. So right now I just have a book proposal and nobody's, you know, I haven't sent it out yet. I'm finalizing it. The idea would be to kind of start online and follow kids and how they kind of fall into this belief system and then see how that belief system, what happens when that kind of spills out into the real world. So what happens when it spills out into medicine, what it does to medicine, and then what happens when it spills out into the broader society. And that's the idea.
Into the families, into the communities.
Yeah.
The schools.
Yeah.
Excellent.
Is it going to be like a thriller novel, like an adventure novel?
It's going to be like thriller, choose your own adventure.
Choose your own agenda.
Anime.
Yeah.
Choose your own agenda. Yeah. I'm going to bring like 15 genres together. And...
Great. I love it. More postmodern art. More postmodern art.
Yeah.
I was talking to my lawyer the other day, and then he told me he'd written a film. And I said, really? Thinking my lawyer shouldn't have written a film. And then he said, yeah, it's horror. How do I attract these people? There you go.
John Grisham did really well for himself. He was a lawyer to begin with.
Okay.
Fair maybe enough. It's a thing.
That's a good point. I hadn't thought
of
that.
Well, at least you said that did he do well in terms of selling novels, or did he do well as a lawyer? Because Stella needs him as a lawyer.
Yeah, good point, Eliza. I wasn't the brightest of me. Yeah.
To be determined, I guess.
Yeah, we'll see.
No, he's well as a novelist. I don't think he's known as the famous lawyer.
Yeah.
Well, thank you, Benjamin. That was very enjoyable.
Thank you so much. And really looking forward to meeting you both next month.
I can't wait. I just can't wait. I have my ideas of what you're both going to be like.
Yeah, me too.
And make sure, Benjamin, when you put it up, won't you be sure to say the GenSpec, give the link of the conference or something?
Oh, yeah, I'll put all the links. So GenSpec conference and Stella's books, Eliza's blog, both of your Twitters. And thank you so much for joining me.
That was really
Thanks, guys.
Bye.
Bye.
There we go.